Stand up for your rights. Keep shining your light. And show the world is strong.
Okay, folks, welcome back. Today we have the honor to learn from Dr. Kulreet Chaudhary, an integrated neurologist who's written an amazing book, The Prime, that I'll talk to you about a little bit more later. He's also been a regular guest on the Dr. Oz Show. Dr. Chaudhary, thank you so much for joining us today.
Oh, it's my pleasure. I can't wait to hear all your wonderful questions.
I think we're going to have a lot of fun just because our backgrounds are kind of brother and sister backgrounds.
True.
So our background is in the Chinese longevity arts. In Chinese medical thought, which history tells us the Chinese borrowed a lot from Ayurveda, the mouth is the center of the body. So can you help us put some of the pieces together regarding the role of the mouth in digestion and the role of digestion in whole being wellness?
Yeah, absolutely. So let's go to, first of all, how the mouth is related to digestion, and then I'll talk about how digestion is really the center of the body. So it's really kind of like the sub-center of the center of the body. So, you know, we always talk about how the eyes are the windows to the soul, and the mouth is really the window to the body. And the mouth, specifically for the digestive system, maps out what is happening. So even in Ayurvedic medicine, and I know in traditional Chinese medicine, we actually do an evaluation of the tongue to see what's going on. And there are specific things that you can tell about digestion, but the mouth is organized in such a way that you can tell what's happening with many of the different organ systems. And so it's kind of this immediate gateway into the digestive system, into all the organ systems that, you know, all you have to do is have a patient stick out their tongue. Now, the second part of your question, though, is digestion being the center of the body, which, you know, as a neurologist, I was totally shocked because I was like, no, the brain is the center of everything, right? But as it turns out, in Ayurvedic medicine, digestion is actually considered the foundational steps for health. And we'll talk about this later, even for brain health. But if you have improper digestion, I mean, it's kind of like one of those duh moments, you know, I mean, as a physician, we were never taught this, but where do you get all of your supplies for energy in the body? It's through digestion. So all of your building blocks come from what? Your digestive tract. But now we're even starting to understand the role of the microbiome, right? The whole population of bacteria, a huge portion which happens to be in the gut. It's not the only place, but it takes it even further from that kind of practical thinking of like, well, of course, because I'm getting all my key nutrients from my digestive system, so it's key. But what we're finding is that your microbiome is like a biological blueprint for your health. So if you're not paying attention to the state of your digestive system, and if you're not paying attention to the state of your microbiome, you are missing this huge opportunity for really manifesting health and vitality in your life.
Right, right.
Was that like a forever answer?
No, that's right on the mark. That's exactly. I'm just going to sit back here in the choir. Yep, exactly, exactly.
Yeah, I know. We'll just high five each other.
Yeah,
right?
Really.
It's so right on.
Yeah. So before I ask you to share your backstory with us, I want to share a few words from your book that I got that really struck a chord with me on, I think it was on page 21. I keep looking down. I've got your book over here. On page 21, you say, I think one of the greatest casualties of modern medicine is the loss of the healing heart of the physician. What a precious reflection, I feel, on our modern global culture. How is it that you, a conventionally trained neurologist, I mean, you studied in the U.S., shifted your stance in some ways rather abruptly, I believe, to include Ayurvedic medicine in your practice? Give us your backstory there.
So, you know, when you said that, this is so funny because I know I wrote the book, but when you said that, I got goosebumps because...
that was my experience. Like, oh my gosh.
Because it is, it's so true, and it's something that is so important for changing healthcare in medicine is really going back to these foundational steps of we become a healing art again.
Right.
And you're right, I can't take full credit by saying like, oh, I'm just this extremely enlightened individual and I just knew this all the time. You know, no, I mean, even though my family had a background in Ayurvedic medicine and I grew up meditating, once I hit medical school, it is a very black and white, it is a very sterile clinical environment, and you are rewarded for being in your head, and you're really kind of you're disqualified when you start speaking from your heart, so to speak.
Right.
That's not really being professional. And so I came out of medical school, I would say very much like most of the other physicians, with this kind of cookie cutter attitude towards patients and health. And even though I had this very rich background, it did not fully survive kind of that. It is a little bit of a warlike environment, because you're not sleeping, you're not really eating, and you're kind of always being bombarded with all of the stresses in residency. And so you do come out kind of a different person. But I ended up with migraine headaches. And so the really big abrupt change for me was when I became a patient. And these weren't the like, oh, I've got a little headache. It was like, okay, I am completely knocked down. I can't think straight. I even after the headaches, don't feel like myself. And so it was a real kind of, come to Jesus moment, where I was like, hey, what am I doing to myself
right.
that is leading to this? And there is nothing that allows in humility for a physician than becoming a patient, right? Because then you get to deal with yourself as a medical system, and then you go, what is going on here? And so it was in that moment, as I came to Ayurvedic medicine now as a patient, and realized how quickly this approach turned around my headaches, and also just how healing the interactions were,
right.
like on the other side of medicine. And I said, wait a minute. Why am I practicing this way? Like, when did I put this armor on?
Yeah.
And if this is alienating for me, and I'm a physician who happened to have to be a patient in a disease category that I was an expert in, so it's not like I was blind, so I even had all of that support around me, and I still felt very alienated. And so then I thought, well, what am I doing to my patients?
Right.
And that was really kind of that moment where everything turned around.
Wow. Why is it that conventional, shall we say, modern medicine training does disconnect the human? I mean, I get the idea that the training is trying to give you objectivity, and so I think that that's probably a lot of it. But I think there's a lot we miss the baby with the bath. We really miss something there.
Yeah, I'm not. I can give you like the 10-hour answer,
right?
Right? Or the shorter one. We'll go to the shorter one. I don't think anything happens overnight. And if you look at even just the way our food changed, right?
Sure.
If we had made the changes, let's say if we went 100 years back, and then if we made all of those changes to our food, like in one day, everybody would be up in arms, right? Because they'd be like, this isn't food anymore.
Sure.
What are you giving us? And so I think these types of changes, they don't happen overnight. And so it's not something that happened just like that. I mean, it happened over history. And then little by little, it became kind of more and more and more acceptable. But if we were to rewind it and go, we started here, then we got here, we would think like, this is cataclysmic. How did this occur?
Right.
But the reality is we got a little more isolated from the wholeness of human experience, then a little bit more, then a little bit more, then a little bit more. And then we ended up with where we are today, where, so many people blame it's big pharma, it's the whole economics of medicine that has caused it. But the reality is we became even susceptible to that only because other changes had occurred before. What I can tell you though, because, I had so many patients who would come into my office and, they went to so many physicians before seeing me, and then they would be like, well, why didn't that doctor tell me this? And why didn't that doctor care?
Right.
Why didn't that doctor put this together? And I said, it's not that they're not caring. I went into medicine because I really cared. All of my colleagues, when we went in, we were so bright-eyed and bushy-tailed, and we're like, we're going to help people. We're going to do all these great things.
Right.
But then just going through the system itself, it kind of inundates you and rewards you, as I said, for thinking in a certain way. And so there's a tremendous amount of creativity that's lost. There's a tremendous amount of individuality that is lost. And in that process, you are cultured into this idea that, just like what you said, if you can't be objective, if you can't take yourself out of the picture, then you're somehow practicing medicine incorrectly. And now we're learning the exact opposite, that it's actually, why would that be helpful? It's actually our ability to care for human beings that sometimes is the only medicine that we can provide.
Truly. Yeah. High five. Wow. So I want to share a parallel story with you. While reading your book, I found a story that brought a huge smile to my face. You shared how when you first started remembering the importance of Ayurveda and took some of your tougher patients to traditional doctors. And on one account, you mentioned how you took some Parkinson's patients and they actually regained their ability to smile, which presumably they had lost due to the progression of the disease, right?
That was really, really a big moment for me because we don't tend to think of those little losses as like huge
Oh
losses
my.
in somebody's humanity. And I have, it's so interesting that you pulled out that moment because it was a really big moment for me, but I think it's sometimes lost on people if you don't know someone with Parkinson's. And it was all of those little stories, and I have another Parkinson's patient who was a dancer. Not a professional dancer, but that's how he and his wife
Right.
bonded. They used to go out dancing and he started dancing again. And it was all of those little stories that somebody started smiling again, somebody started dancing again, that led me through kind of, that dark place that everybody has to go through, right? When you're going to do something that's against the system, you have to go through this very isolated,
Yeah.
lonely place where the world is telling you, you're crazy, you shouldn't be doing this. And in that dark moment, I had these amazing stories from patients that just kept me going. And it was just this reinvitation of humanity back into medicine.
Right.
I mean, just the fact that a husband was able to smile at his wife, like, I can't tell you what that meant to them. I mean, think about it. Somebody that you love, you can't show them through
Right.
your expression that you love them. And so just regaining that was like my. That was my fuel for a lot of lonely years out there.
Absolutely. So here's our version. Many years ago, a customer of ours wrote us sharing how he had benefited from using our products. It was this email testimonial that we got that actually helped us clarify and realize our mission, our broader sense. I mean, we came onto the business saying, "Okay, God, where's our home-based business that does no harm, that really helps people, that is really fulfilling for us?" And so we started talking to people about what Susan had done with advanced gum disease many years earlier. It wasn't until this email, though, he shared with us that since using our products, he had begun to smile more. Same story. And it
Yes,
was that
yes.
day that we realized that our work is to help people bring more smiles onto the planet. I mean, if we all can help people smile more, then I feel that's a good life.
Can I share a brief story with
Please.
you along those lines? This was actually told to me by one of my, I call her one of my spiritual teachers. And she was describing the story of this young man who was another student of hers. Who was planning on committing suicide that day, and had mapped it all, very young guy, and had mapped it all out, and was going down with a plan, and at some point had to leave the house for something, and was about to cross the street, and a lady who was driving past him just turned to him and smiled. That was it, just
That's
turned
it.
to him and smiled, and because of that one smile, he said, if she sees something in me worth smiling at, maybe there is something worth saving. And he actually foiled the plan was foiled because of one smile. Like, that's how huge we can be as human beings. And I think we forget the power that is within us and something as little as a smile, what that can do.
Yeah.
And when we saw patients in our clinic, every time I saw a patient, I walked in with a smile and always started with a hug. That was just the way we greeted patients.
Right. And how much different is the healing process as a result? I
It's
mean,
completely different.
yeah, like we said, like I told you before we started the interview, I'm gonna come visit you.
Almost sounds like a threat. Let me come
I've got
visit
family
you. I'm
lining
going to
up.
smile at
Yeah,
you.
really. Okay, so let's shift specifically, even though, I believe that as a generality, modern medicine tends to over and compartmentalize the body. Let's shift kind of to oral health. We talk a lot about healing the psychic disconnect many of us have with our mouths. It seems that we as a culture have lost contact with the simple fact that our mouths are the primary point of entry for new stuff into our bodies. what we put in our mouths has a big impact on our whole body health. How can we begin to repair this disconnect with our mouths, in your opinion?
So, I mean, this is, you know, I guess a slightly biased answer, because this is what I found to be so powerful. And it was making the brain gut connection. Mm-hmm. And, you know, kind of the way I describe it is going from a dumb gut to a smart gut. Mm-hmm. And what I mean by that, and this is really what the basis of the entire book is to change what is happening in your GI tract and to change what is happening in your brain from a biochemical standpoint, which is resulting in so many of these, we call them subconscious behaviors, but what they really are is that they're just biochemically driven behaviors where people are either stress eating or, you know, they're really eating out of food addictions. Yep. And, you know, that to, and the whole purpose of the book is to explain that your gut is actually communicating with your brain and telling you what to eat via these bacteria and other organisms that live within it. And on top of that, your brain, the way that it responds to stress or happiness, sends signals back down to your gut. And that also changes the type of organisms that live in that. So I, for me, a big part of it is to take the personal aspects of it out, because a lot of people think, I'm just not motivated. I have, you know, they get guilty about it, that I just have poor self-control. And so they get into all of this guilt and blame. And it's like, you know, it's biochemical. Like, you don't blame yourself right. for the amount of dopamine you do or don't have. Like, you don't think about those things. You're like, oh, well, no, that I understand is biochemistry. And so just accept that, yes, we are people, but we are people swimming in a biochemical soup, and then change the ingredients in that soup by changing the biochemistry. And then you take kind of the personal battle out of it. And that's basically what I saw, you know, in my medical practice, that people struggled with changing what they were putting in their mouth. But in a sense, this had nothing to do with it. It was this connection between brain and gut. And when we focused on just bringing that smart gut back in, what they put into their mouth spontaneously changed.
Right, right. It just shifts. Totally makes sense. So there's plenty to cry foul about in the dental industry. So, and we are very solution focused. We're very, you know, we used to write about some of the stuff. We're like, you know, we don't want to go there anymore. We just want to stay focused on helping people find a healthier path. So I want to touch on this, but if you don't want to stay here long, I'm perfectly fine with that. Let's touch on mercury. And what are your thoughts around the relative risks of mercury toxicity from amalgam fillings? And is this a real concern to just hype, in your opinion?
So I think it's a great question. So let me answer it kind of in two different ways.
Okay.
I think we're at this cusp in history, at least I'm keeping my fingers crossed, that we're starting to finally understand that environmental toxins, including, you know, what we put into our mouth, matter, right? And, you know, we're starting to realize it's not even something that's happening in terms of pollution in the air or water, but just even like, what are they putting on our furniture? What are they putting on our clothes? Like, all of these chemicals, we're getting, you know, bombarded by it. And so I think people are naturally coming to this place of saying, well, what can I control? Because there are certain things you can't control, right? Because mercury in the air from China is showing up on like the West Coast.
Right.
And it's like, well, I can't control that.
Right.
So what can I control? And so I think it's a, you know, and myself included, I had, you know, mercury amalgams, but I would never let my son have them. You know, unfortunately, I mean, knock on wood, somewhere he doesn't have cavities because
right.
we control his sugar intake. But if he does develop them, you know, we wouldn't go to mercury. And this, you know, the second part of it is, though, if you do have them, what to do? And this is how I look at it. People are sometimes more focused on the mercury amalgam than that Big Mac they're also putting in their mouth. Okay. And, you know, they will complain that trying to eat organic is too expensive, but they're putting like pesticides and, you know, other extremely harmful chemicals into their mouth on a daily basis. Now, I'm not saying that you shouldn't do something about it if it is part of your overall health plan,
right.
but it does not make sense to me to go after. And by the way, I still have one mercury amalgam, which I haven't done anything about, but it's because my overall toxicity in terms of how I eat and, you know, how I live, and also my ability to process heavy metals is so good that I'm going to cross that bridge, you know, and I still plan on doing something, but I'm going to cross that bridge maybe like in the next, you know, couple of years when I feel like I can make time in my schedule to do a cleanse beforehand and after, because I take it very seriously. When you remove mercury, also,
Absolutely.
it's, you know, it's a process. But I am so much more attentive to what am I putting in my mouth on a daily basis? What am I putting in my mind? Which, I mean, I'm just absolutely shocked at how strong our thoughts affect our body. I'm really, really starting to appreciate that now. And so I would just advise somebody who is in this debate to say, look, if this is really matters to you, let's just take then the focus from amalgams a little bit wider and say, where else is our toxins coming into your life? And let's include that into this picture.
Right.
Does that make
Totally.
sense?
Yeah. To kind of look at the whole body burden instead of
Yeah,
just one.
I don't ever have like one superhero and one villain in my mind about anything.
Right.
You know, it's always about who's eating this, or who is asking the question, what is your whole body or whole life toxic burden? And then I can begin to give you a meaningful answer. But it's never just like, this thing is always evil, this thing is always good.
Right.
It's always in reference to the person where they're at.
Sure. I mean, anytime you go to an extreme, right, then you're going rigid, and then you're actually inviting more problems, more stagnation.
It's absolutely true. Absolutely
Yeah.
true.
Do you see a connection between chronic inflammation provoked from an imbalanced oral microbiome, namely increased presence of, let's say, spirochetes with periodontal disease and neurodegenerative diseases?
So, do you mind if I unpack that just a
Please,
little
yeah.
bit? Okay. So, as a neurologist, I would put it this way. I look very much at oral health and brain health, and again, as an extension, gut health. And even in some of the work that you know, some of the neuroscientists and neurologists are doing now in conditions like Alzheimer's disease, we're making the connection
Right.
that oral health matters. And so, to me, it's not so much a necessarily a cause and effect. It's just that when you have chronic inflammation, you will also, like, you've got to take care of the inflammation in all of the organs in which it's present. You will definitely have, and from my perspective, you know, neurodegenerative conditions almost, you know, I'm trying to think of a condition, except the rare occasion where it was like a tropical infection. But in most cases, there is some aspect of inflammation in the GI tract. And so, by extension, the mouth, I can't think of a case where both didn't exist at the same time. Now, that does not mean, in my book, that you just have really, really good oral health. And again, you know, eat your Big Mac,
Right.
but you're going to floss right
Right.
afterwards. It means that you're really cleaning up where that inflammation is coming from. And when you do that, it has a direct impact, you know, on the brain.
Right.
So, you know, it's again, because we do tend to over compartmentalize. And so people will say, well, okay, I'm gonna get like the most expensive, you know, toothbrush and like floss, you know, 5 times a day, and will that get rid of my multiple sclerosis? And it's like, wait a minute, no, you're missing the
Right.
point. Your oral health is coming from some kind of balance or imbalance in the body. Let's focus on bringing that balance back
Right.
and then repairing the brain.
Right. I've got a question there. Let me see if I can frame it.
Okay.
So again, it's kind of the over compartmentalization. We can be as the patient can be as victimized, if you will, as the medical industry to over compartmentalize things.
Very much. And I think we have taught patients to be that way, unfortunately, because we will look at them in compartments, and so then they begin to look at themselves. And you know, this is going back to kind of that original question of physicians as healers. When we accept our role as healers, we become teachers.
Right.
You know, and we become teachers of life, not just biology, but really of life, of how to be expansive, how to understand how energy flows, you know, through our being. And so unfortunately, you know, we have taught patients to take that one pill or take that one intervention. And what we're starting to realize, and this is where a lot of my work is going into, is the old way we study things where we had one variable and then we studied the outcome. That doesn't make any sense.
Right.
It's systems approach. You know, in order to get real disease reversal, you usually have to do like 15 or 20 things, you know, including addressing oral health. I mean, Dr. Bredesen's MEND protocol, I'm not sure if you're familiar with that, but it was a study looking at the reversal of Alzheimer's disease, and it was a small pilot, but it was successful. You know, he was successfully able to actually reverse Alzheimer's disease in this small group of patients. But it was not one thing. It was multiple steps.
Right.
It was, you know, taking gluten out of the diet, reducing the intake of meat. And then oral health was one component of that.
Right.
And that's really kind of the change we have to make, is that it's never one thing. It's always a combination of things. And to be okay with the fact that you don't know if this one aspect was 10% of the solution and that aspect was, you know, 50% of the solution, but just realize that the body is an organism. There's a wholeness in there, and there has to be a wholeness in our approaches. And even worse yet, the way that a patient responds also depends on their own unique microbiome. I mean, that is like sending the scientific community into a tailspin, because now we're realizing like, oh, wait a minute, people don't even respond to the same intervention the same way. And it in part depends on your unique microbiome.
Right. Right. So maybe the flaw then is, I mean, I get that you can't have a double blind controlled study if you have multiple variables. So maybe the flaw is the way that we all have approached validating medical science.
This is exactly correct. And there are people who are, you know, and myself and the group that I work with is included in this, but there are people within the scientific community that have come to realize this and are trying to make amends with this and saying, okay, how do we still be scientific, but also be truthful about what it actually takes to, you know, bring disease under control?
Right, right. Well put. So let's talk about solutions. Actually, let me back up. I want to hear, do you have any patient stories you'd like to share with us, how people have transformed their lives by changing something seemingly unrelated to their problem?
Oh my gosh. I mean, I've got like thousands and thousands of stories. But there's one in particular. She always amazed me, and she has always stood out, not only in my mind, but in my heart. And it was, you know, a lady with multiple sclerosis who came in and she said, look, I know this is going to require change. And she goes, let me explain my situation. She was in a very abusive relationship and actually worked with her abusive husband. And she had a daughter who was a heroin addict and in and out of rehab. She goes, this is my situation. Can you help me? And I said, yeah, but, you know, we're going to take it one step at a time. We're going to just take it one step at a time. We don't have to make it any more complicated. I'm not going to say, go leave your husband and, you know, emotionally detach from your daughter. I mean, like, you know, who does that like right off the bat, right? And so she was drinking 8 sodas a day. And I said, could you go to 6? And so she goes, yeah. And so she came back a month later and I said, could you go to 4? Yeah. And she came back a month later and then 2 and then 0. And then we started bringing in some positive habits like the prime tea, which I mentioned, you know, in the book, and several other things that I mentioned in the book we did for her. We added Trifla. We added, you know, some of the supplementations and some of the healthy habits. We added meditation gradually. And like little by little by little by little, you know, over the course of time, she had stabilized her disease. But I still remember, and that, you know, that should have been significant enough, right? She was no longer having any new lesions. There were no active lesions. No neurological symptoms. That should have been enough. But the reason why she stands out is I think it was like around 18 months working together. She came in and, you know, was still married to her abusive husband and still was working with him. And her daughter was still in and out of rehab. But she came in and she said, Dr. Chaudhary, I got to tell you something. And I said, yeah, what? And she goes, I'm happy. And she said it in such a surprised way. She goes, now, I shouldn't be happy. Like, you know, I still have all these things going on. She goes, but I'm happy. And I said, and for me, I like, you know, I think I started tearing at the moment. And I said, this is the eureka moment, because your happiness, first of all, it's biochemical in nature. And we had been working on her biochemistry. You are not happy because of your circumstances. That's a huge, huge myth, that you will be happy because of your circumstances. So she had all of the circumstances that where people should be unhappy, but she was happy because she had the biochemistry of happiness. We had worked on that. And so for an MS patient, the fact that her MS was stable, and that was a secondary point, to me, it was like she got it.
Right.
She got that, you know, you're bigger than your body, you're bigger than your circumstances, that your happiness is your birthright, and it's just the result of balancing your biochemistry.
Mm.
And that's always one of the stories that really stood out in my mind, because she had all the reasons not to be.
Totally.
And yet, you know, she just followed the steps, and it was little steps, just one little step at a time, and she got there.
Wow.
And that to me is just like a metaphor for life. Just one little step at a time, you'll get there.
Yeah. And the one little step is huge, because otherwise it's like, how do I, you know, how do you eat an elephant? Eat one bite at a time.
Exactly.
Right. What I'm reminded of by that is I've got one of my favorite books around here. Is actually an ancient, I think it's Greek, from a guy named Epictetus, that the quote goes something to the effect of, it's not what happens to us, but how we interpret or react to what happens to us.
That's absolutely right.
And how does that then shift our microbiome that changes our gut?
Exactly. And that's what I love about this change that's happening right now in medicine. Is it's taking the poetry of medicine and bringing it back, because now we can take quotes like that, right?
Right.
And we can then extrapolate that and explain how our, you know, brain scans are changing in response to just our perception and how our microbiome is changing. But then we can come back to the quote and say, this is a valid quote. This isn't like woo-woo anymore.
Right.
This is a valid quote, because it actually is, you know, changing you on the most fundamental basis more powerfully than any of our medications can.
Ooh, yeah. Good one. Okay. So oil pulling is the rave these days.
It's been the rave for about 5,000
years.
Yeah,
really.
But,
that's true. But now that we've got a few celebrities doing it, then that kind of brings people's attention to it. So can you help us put into perspective the idea of how traditional daily hygiene habits, like oil pulling, and the impact that they have? For example, does oil pulling benefit more than just our mouths? And if so, how?
So it's a great question. And I've written a lot about this for the same reason, you know, people started doing it. And so then it became really like sexy and popular. And, you know, we of course are like laughing because it's been written in these texts, right, for like thousands and thousands of years.
Right.
And so it's like, yeah, then everything old is new again.
Yeah.
But basically, so there's two perspectives of it. And one is kind of the more local perspective, that the oil, it helps to disrupt the plaques in that biofilm that so many bacteria and other organisms make. And so it disrupts the local growth of organisms. And of course we know, you know, if you have bacteria growing in any particular part of your body, it's going to trigger inflammation, you know, everywhere. But there's a much more elegant stance to this in Ayurvedic medicine. And that's kind of the part that I want to focus on. And that's how we link oil pulling to all of these other wonderful effects. Now, first of all, whenever we say oil pulling will improve, you know, acne, it'll improve digestion, it'll improve migraines, we're never just doing oil pulling. And we now, I'm speaking, of course, on behalf of the entire Ayurvedic community, but when we say that, we're never talking about it in isolation.
Sure.
So we're always talking about it in coordination with, you know, a particular dietary approach, in coordination with a particular daily routine. And that's why it's given so much, you know, so much glory, because it's not in isolation. But the idea is that detoxifying on a daily basis, even if it's small detoxification, when you add it up, it's powerful.
Right.
And so oil pulling, it's a two-way street. So, you know, you can absorb things into your mouth, but you can also pull things out of your mouth. So the idea is that oil pulling every single day, you are helping to pull toxins out of the bloodstream through the salivary glands because of this lipophilic property of the oil. So it's the fat loving or the property of the oil, where it will pull certain types of toxins that only dissolve in fat out of the salivary glands via, you know, then the bloodstream. So it's like a suctioning effect.
Right.
And for people who do have a lot of toxins, especially like for people who have mercury or other heavy metal exposure, it is amazing the stuff that comes out. I mean, they will get like these dark, dark, dark deposits on the tongue. And then the second part of oil pulling, though, is the tongue scraping. So,
right.
you know, you use typically a stainless steel. Do you, you've got, yeah, there you go.
That was a question I was going to throw at you spontaneously.
Yeah, no, the next one, I read minds. So the next part is the tongue scraping, but you pull the toxins out, you know, partly through the tongue, partly through the saliva, spit it out, and then scrape it off with the tongue scraper. Now, if you only did that once in your life, you may not have, you know, such a huge benefit, but it's just like everything else. When you do little things every single day, and then you start to do multiple little things every single day, your health starts to shift.
Right. Right. Well put. Well put. So along the line of oil pulling, this is actually the question that led me originally to you specifically. So let's see if you can help us shine some light here.
Sure.
Traditionally, oil pulling is practiced with sesame oil. Yet so many people these days on the internet espouse the benefits of using coconut oil for oil pulling. Now, this, I know the reason that we haven't spoken about this yet to our community is because it really, once you open up this box of talking about the doshas, then you start, okay, now you got to really explain a whole other world. But, coconut oil pulling is really popular. When I pondered this originally, I thought, well, maybe the traditional Indian culture didn't have coconuts, which I know, like, that's ridiculous. Okay, tons of coconuts. So
we had coconuts.
Yeah. So why does Ayurveda teach oil pulling with sesame oil and not coconut oil? And in particular, is there a way that using coconut oil could be imbalancing to the body?
Okay. So first of all, you know, my general approach to things are, when you are doing a very healthy habit like oil pulling, don't let the choice of should it be sesame oil or coconut oil stop you from doing it. Like, first of all, just do it.
Right.
And then sort this stuff out, because it's going to help no matter what. So the reason traditionally in Ayurvedic medicine, sesame oil has been used because sesame oil, the way it is described, it's more permeating. Mm-hmm. So when you want to get the really deep toxins out of the body, we will use sesame oil. So that's true for like oil enemas. It's true for a lot of the Ayurvedic massages and a lot of the treatments that are done in Panchakarma. When you are looking for deeper detoxification, you will use sesame oil. It has, especially cured sesame oil, which just means it's slightly warmed, and then you cool it down and you can put it back into the jar. But so it's an understanding of the properties of the oil beyond just, you know, what it might do to a particular area. And so many, many preparations, even preparations that will have coconut oil, will still have sesame oil in it. Mm. So if you can't decide, if you're still like, I can't do this because I have to know if it's sesame oil or coconut oil, mix them together and just do it. Like, just do it. You know?
Yeah.
Just mix them together and do it. Now, you're asking a very good question, though. Why is coconut oil becoming more popular? I think, you know, the diseases of the time will dictate taste to a certain extent. And what we have right now, especially in America, maybe less in Hawaii, but, you know, for us in the mainland, we have a lot of inflammation. And inflammation, which, you know, you mentioned the doshas, is usually in part due to pitta dosha. So that tends to be overheated. And so coconut oil is known for its ability to reduce heat. Mm. Now, where is all this heat coming from? From multiple sources, the way that we're eating, the amount of stress we're under, but also many of our medications are considered to actually be very, very heating to the liver.
Makes sense.
And so it creates all of this heat in the digestive system. And I mean, most people are on like 8-9 medications nowadays. And even if you're not on medication, you know, I hate to tell you this, you're getting it through your drinking water.
Sure.
Because we're all basically consuming whatever the human population is on. And so I think because of that, and because coconut oil does have that immediate response to reducing inflammation, that might be part of the popularity. Well, I would still suggest, though, again, either mixing them together or start with coconut. And then once you see the initial real redness go down, switch to sesame, because sesame does do something different for your body in terms of uprooting some of the deeper toxins. It's more permeating and pulling out beyond just the gum line beyond just the mouth, it goes a little bit further.
Totally makes sense. So oil pull in general with whatever, and if you want to take it beyond the mouth, then consider sesame oil or a mix.
Yeah, or a mix. Easy.
Totally makes sense. So what about canker sores? Any gems off the top of your head for someone who suffers from canker sores, what this means? You know, what's your interpretation there?
Okay, where should I begin? I love canker sores. for a few reasons. I've had family members who get canker sores where I'm like, how do you not know what this is from? But they're also, I love them because they're an easy fix. Not that I personally love having them. I'm saying I love them because they're generally an easy fix. So for canker sores, you have to look at two different aspects of the body. So let's look first at the physical body. Canker sores are always a reaction to being overheated. And usually it means GI inflammation, too much heat. And so, again, bringing this back to the Ayurvedic perspective and the doshas, we would say get rid of the foods that are pitta aggravating, the foods that increase heat. So a lot of the fiery foods, you know, chilies, sour foods, ginger, garlic, onions, all of that, alcohol, coffee, those are all heating foods. But, you know, in Ayurvedic medicine, and I know this is true in, you know, traditional Chinese medicine as well, there are different levels of the body, right? And canker sores in particular tend to be associated with certain disruptions in the emotional body, particularly anger. And it can be one of two types of angers, either expressed or unexpressed, meaning it can either be the person who tends to always be angry or the person who's angry but is holding it in and so it erupts.
Right.
And so, you know, it's, of course, you need to address the foods you're eating that are causing this, but I cannot believe, and there's certain herbs that also help to address anger, particularly herbs, and you can relate to this, the herbs that help with liver,
sure.
You know, liver heat. But I can't believe what a huge epiphany it is for people when they relate the emotion linked to a particular condition. And when they start to release that emotion, how like they just go away like that.
Right. Well, you're dealing with the fundamental structure of it, then you're changing the basis.
Yeah. And it's always interesting to me. The reason why I chuckled is because my mom has a tendency towards getting these. And she always gets them when she is in a place where she starts kind of, you know, piercing words. And because she's had such a long meditation practice, what I've realized is when you are meditating long, you can't get away with much. Like, very early in, it's like, you know, universal kind of really win. And the second she starts to get them, I just gotta laugh because I'm like, who have you been yelling
yeah.
at lately? Well, I wasn't yelling.
Yeah.
I was just explaining to the banker why he was wrong.
Of course, I would never go to yell, but like you said, the meditation has taken the edge off of my anger.
Yeah.
That's classic. Classic. So you talk a lot about the gut-brain axis in your book, how our digestive health directly impacts our brain health. And in particular, one thing I just read a couple days ago, I didn't realize that on a developmental level, they're actually from the same tissue. So it's actually one brain, essentially.
Exactly. That's how I look at it now.
Do you have any suggestions for someone listening that they could apply in their lives if they feel that they could use support in their digestive health? For example, we have an article that brings solutions how to tone and stimulate the vagus nerve to support greater communication. You know, we talk about gagging with tongue cleaning while scraping the tongue to generate the vagal tone. Mm-hmm. Are there any broad brush strokes that generally we can all benefit from in regards to stimulating the gut-brain axis?
Absolutely. I mean, unfortunately, we're at a point in history where we're eating so bad that you can almost do anything and improve.
Really?
You know, I've had patients who've come to me and said, you know, you're brilliant at Ayurvedic medicine. I said, I wish I was, but I'm really not. It's just because I'm practicing in America, almost anything I do to benefit people. I said, but the real people who are brilliant at this are the people who are like in India, you know, where they're dealing with communities, although this is getting less rare, you know, more rare even there. It's getting less common there. But, you know, when you're dealing with communities that are eating really healthy, and then when somebody gets a disease, that's really difficult to treat because they're already doing a lot of right things. For me, it's super, super easy because I can like throw, you know, a piece of ginger at someone and they like feel better.
Right.
But some very simple things. And, you know, the book, the whole guidelines in the book are on this topic, but just some simple things that you can do. Moving your largest meal from dinner time to lunchtime. Simple, simple, simple. And lunch is actually when your digestion is stronger. So you're not creating all these toxic byproducts. I'm not saying you have to change anything you eat. Throughout the entire book, I never once tell anybody to change what they're eating. I'm just adding things and rearranging things for optimal health. So just changing your dinner, whatever you would eat, to lunchtime, really simple fix, doesn't cost you any more. Another really simple thing to do is the prime tea. The recipe is in the book, but it's really easy to make. Oh, is that what you're drinking? I was looking at that and I was like, that looks a lot like prime tea. Yeah. But it's just, you know, one teaspoon of cumin, coriander, and fennel seeds in about 4 to 5 cups of water. Depending on how strong you want it, you can either add boiling water and let it steep, or if you want it stronger, you can boil it, you know, for about 10 minutes, either way. But, you know, just drinking that throughout the day, it just immediately starts to encourage the right type of bacteria in your GI tract and remove toxins. Another really simple fix, which, you know, also mentioned in the book, is just adding an herb called trifla, and that's spelled T-R-I-P-H-A-L-A. It's just a combination of three berries, but incorporating that into your daily routine. I mean, that, you know, we call it an herb. There are really three berries. It's really, yeah. it's a food. But that particular combination of those, you know, foods, it's amazing what it does for gut health. So, you know, even just any one of those three things, you're going to feel, you know, you're going to feel better. I'm more concerned, although this is a wonderful concern to have, this is my hope, is to be concerned, is that maybe in 30 years, we will have finally figured all this out. And then I'm really going to be challenged, because then we won't have so many of like the real lifestyle illnesses. And, you know, then I will have to become a better Ayurvedic practitioner, because now I'm really going to have to work at
right.
it, because it's not just simply that everybody's eating so poorly.
Right. It won't be as simple. Totally. You know, when I bought your book, I don't know, a couple of weeks ago when I first reached out to you. And so I got totally caught into it just reading it online, because Amazon's like, oh, you know, okay, you know, here's this little excerpt from it. And I'm like, wow, I'm so excited to get the book now. Started drinking the prime tea, started sleeping better right away. I'm like, wow, I've got deeper, sounder sleep. And if we pause for a moment and think about what's the implication if we slowly lose the quality of our sleep over time,
exactly.
How does that undermine everything? I mean, we've interviewed other experts that specialize in sleep dentistry and sleep appliances and stuff just to help deal with sleep apnea. I mean, if we don't get good rest, we undermine our adrenal health, which undermines yeah. everything.
Everything, yeah. And it's the same with digestive health. And
yeah.
that's going back to what, you know, Ayurvedic medicine said, is digestion is the source of all health. And so we see this all the time. And, you know, all you did is what? It's a simple tea, right?
Yeah.
It's the easiest thing to do. And as soon as people add it on, they notice improvement. And then they'll add like one other little recommendation from, you know, the book on, and they're like, oh, and I notice even more improvement. And these are healthy people. Even healthy people notice improvement.
Right. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Good stuff. So you have the book, obviously, called The Prime, which is super awesome, folks. I was sharing this with Dr. Casey before we started the video. When I first looked at it, I'm like, I'm going to read, it's a weight loss book. I mean, I'm like, I've been the same weight my whole adult life. But I'm like, you know, I'm going to read it because I'm interested in what she has to say. It's totally not a weight loss book. I mean, it affects, I mean, will you tell us the story? I mean, you should be telling the story. Tell us how you kind of accidentally came into this.
Well, tell me the story about the book.
Tell us how you accidentally came into a no-stress spontaneous weight loss program as a neurologist.
I never thought this was a weight loss program. And the funny thing is, you know, over the decade that I've been doing this for patients, and they lost, you know, lots of weight. I mean, we had patients who lost up to 100 pounds. Most of our patients lost, you know, 30 pounds, 20 to 30 pounds was fairly average. Like almost everybody who came into our clinic lost weight. I didn't care that they lost weight. I had a program for neurodegenerative diseases. And then pretty soon I had people who were coming in for other conditions, but the weight loss to me was totally incidental.
Yeah.
Because I was just basically getting rid of the toxic inflammation, getting the brain-gut connection back online, and improving the microbiome. And what happens when you do that is you will lose weight, but it's just spontaneous And to me, it was such an obvious thing that I never even really talked about it. And it wasn't until, you know, when I was finally asked to write this book, and, you know, I never even intended to write a book. I had a book agent who reached out to me, and I was like, well, I don't think I'm doing anything, you know, really unusual. I do have this, you know, neurodegenerative program. And I literally, it was like a teeny tiny little phrase in my conversation. I'm like, and, you know, and people tend to lose weight. He's like, wait, lose weight? I'm like, yeah, but it just happens spontaneous. But it's just a side effect. It's not a big deal. And he was like, you created a program that makes people more energetic, clear minds, and they accidentally lose weight. And they're like, this is brilliant. But it was never something that I was really focused on, because my focus was on how do I get people healthy? And the reality is, and you know, I now just acknowledge this reality, that we do live in a society where people really are struggling with weight because they don't understand the biochemistry that really leads to it. And so they are interested in this. And if that is the reason that they are going to have more energy, have a sharper mind, you know, have stronger gut brain connection and just stronger digestion, like, I don't care if people do it because they want to lose weight. Right. I just want people to feel liberated while they're living in their body.
Well put. So any other gems or insights you'd like to share with our community?
I think just one big one, and this actually does center around the whole issue of weight since we talked about it. One of the things that really surprised me, because as I, you know, as I practiced and as people started losing weight, what happened even in my own clinic is more and more people started talking about it, and they're like, you know, because people say, how'd you lose 30 pounds? How'd you lose 40 pounds? Like, oh, my neurologist. They're like, your neurologist. And so pretty soon I started getting more and more and more of a weight loss community coming to my clinic totally accidentally. And the one thing I saw over and over was the guilt associated with this. And, you know, I think that guilt is expanded beyond just even weight loss, but just the guilt of feeling sick and the guilt of feeling like I've done this to myself. And I really am hoping, you know, through the book that guilt, that self-judgment is lifted off, because we don't tend to do that when we get certain diagnoses, and we tend to do it when we get other diagnoses.
Right.
And, you know, obesity is a diagnosis, it's a medical diagnosis, but it is a diagnosis that carries so much guilt with it. And I saw patients that were, you know, amazing. I mean, launched careers, ran households, you know, they were highly disciplined and they could not lose weight, but it's because of the biochemistry that has been created. I mean, through the food industry, through the way we're practicing medicine, all of this. And it's not helpful at all. And the way that most physicians treat patients just make them feel worse, because they're like, just stop eating.
Right.
It's not that easy.
Right.
There's an entire biochemistry set in motion to make you eat the way you are. So I'm just hoping that, you know, the book and the message in the book brings that liberation to people, that they go, oh my God, I have been blaming myself for something that is happening to us as a community, as a civilization, and is way bigger than any one person's motivation.
Right. Right. And to shrug the emotional weight,
yeah,
that we have a tendency to heap upon ourselves when we find ourselves in that situation.
It's very alienating, you know, very, very isolating. I think that was the huge relief that so many patients felt when they came in, because I never even talked about weight in my clinic.
Yeah.
To me, it was irrelevant. I was just looking at what's happening to your digestion.
Right.
That's all I cared about.
Right.
And they felt safe. And I, you know, it was just amazing to me how isolated
right.
people felt because of this.
Yeah. So where can our community learn more about you?
The easiest way is just to go to our website, and it's the Prime Club, and it's just literally theprimeclub.com, and that's where I post kind of most of my updates, and that's where our online community lives as well, and we've created, you know, this amazing online program to accompany people in the book, mainly because people want to do this together, and
sure.
so we said, okay, we will build that for you.
Yeah, yeah, perfect. Dr. Kulreet Chaudhary, thank you so much.
It's been my pleasure. Stand up for your friend.